Hi there, and welcome back to episode 2 of this Love is a Verb series. If you haven't watched episode 1, here is the link. Check it out and catch up. The last time we spoke about the first 5 attributes that make a healthy relationship mapped onto your customer experience, and they were love and commitment, quality time, trust, intimacy, and effective communication. And today we're going to go through the next five attributes that make a successful relationship. Why are we talking about love as a verb? We're talking about it because as we emerge into this digital world, this digital first world, our digital interactions as brands and businesses are increasing at pace. And really the concern is we're losing some human. I mean, digital convenience is fantastic, digital speed, instant, all brilliant, but are we losing that human empathy, that human connection? And particularly post-pandemic, there is of course a yearning for customers, whether it's B2B or B2C, to connect in a new way, to connect in an authentic way, in a genuine way. And so human relationship and customer lifetime value are critical to our success. So listen, let's get into the next 5 attributes here of what makes a successful human relationship and how you can take that and map it onto customer experience and deepen your relationships with your customers. And also, of course, in your own personal life. Keep a note and take a look at these 5 and see what you can do in your own personal relationships with your friends and your family and your partner to deepen those relationships. So let's get straight into it. The first one is conflict and fair fighting. There's an American psychiatrist called John Gottman, and he is an expert in marital and divorce relationships. And he predicts with a 94% accuracy, a very exact figure, whether a couple will make it or break based on sometimes only one session with him. And he mainly looks at conflict and how two people deal with conflict. And the couples who approach conflict as a team generally make it, and the ones that approach it from an individual basis don't. What we're saying here is, in a personal relationship, if you approach conflict, and there'll always be some form of conflict in any relationship, whether it's personal or business, if you approach conflict trying to win, trying to be right, that's not a healthy way of approaching conflict, because what you're trying to do is approach conflict from an individual perspective. The couples that approach conflict with how can we become stronger from this? How can we work together through this to the benefit of the relationship, not to the individual, but to the benefit of the relationship? They're the couples that make it. And the same in business. Any conflict, whether it's a process, customer journey piece of conflict, whether we let the customer down, we need to make sure we repair and we approach that conflict in a way of how, at the end of this, will our relationship with our customer be stronger? And if you ask that question, often the answer would be very different to maybe what you would have done otherwise. So conflict is, I mean, there's so many types of ways we let customers down. Look at this one from Tesco, and the dog ends up being pink, you know? I mean, so should the shampoo have turned my dog pink? And you might excuse that, it's only a dog. But you mightn't excuse this from Lush Cosmetics. The same thing happens. A girl turns her skin pink. So obviously there's times with brands when we kind of drop the ball as brands and we do that. And even actually sometimes you can even take a moment of conflict and turn it into a positive. I love this one from this coffee shop that says, come in and taste the coffee that one woman on TripAdvisor said was the worst in her life. And you know, this idea of you can take kind of a gritty moment on the customer journey, but also make it a positive. So have a look at conflict and have a look at any moment you have an opportunity to deepen the relationship with your customer, take it and approach that conflict point in a way of how can we be stronger together at the end of this, not just as an individual. That's number 6. Number 7, the 7th most important thing from an attribute from a healthy relationship is acts of service. And we do these automatically often when we're in new relationships. Acts of service, bringing your loved one a cup of coffee in the morning, doing the laundry or washing up when it wasn't your turn, clearing the paper jam in the printer in the office even though you didn't cause it. Anything that you show affection and love for somebody else by doing something for them. Gift giving is a big part of this too. So acts of service, why do we do these things? We do these things because we show we care. That's really, really important. And I think as a brand and business, we have an opportunity always to show the customer that we care and the little things that we do. Don't wait until the obvious moment in a customer journey to communicate with your customer. So they take the insurance industry, you know, communicating once a year at the renewal. That's expected and it's not very warm. Whereas other times during the customer journey, if you communicate with me, if you do little things for me, that's how we deepen relationships. I love one example. A story you may have heard it before from the Ritz-Carlton. This guy called Chris Hearn goes on vacation with his family, his 8-year-old kid. They go home after their trip, but the 8-year-old kid leaves his little giraffe teddy bear, Joshy, in the bedroom by accident. Of course, he's really upset when he gets home. He has to sleep with the teddy. And so the father reaches out to the hotel saying, please, can you look for the teddy? And the hotel says, yeah, look, we found it. It was in the laundry. No worries, we'll mail it back to you. And when they mailed back the teddy, they included a binder in the package of Joshy on his vacation in the Ritz-Carlton. And here's some pictures of it. Joshy was at the pool, he was at the spa, he even got a job as a loss prevention officer. So this is a wonderful moment where you really bring a brand to life. It's just a little things that we do to make the brand a bit more special. special to someone. So think about your customer journey and think about how you can maybe drop in a couple of acts of service, little things that you do for your customers to make them smile, to make them feel that they're special, and to kind of show that love. Remember, love is a verb. Okay, next one. What do we do with personal responsibility? So sometimes you have to take personal responsibility. A sense of personal responsibility is important in relationships. You have to take ownership of your own stuff. And so in a relationship, often you hear people say, oh my God, he completes me, she completes me, which is a very dangerous thing, because it's what we call a codependent relationship. You want to be interdependent, but not codependent, not relying on each other. But the weird thing is, in business, we do rely on our customers. We rely on them to keep us in business. And so we have to kind of learn to maybe give more than we get in relationships. And I'm worried that in a B2B and a B2C relationship, sometimes the corporation, us, we get the money, we give them product or service, and we think that's enough. But actually, I don't think it is. I think we need to go further. And also, in terms of relationship, before you get into a personal relationship, you're supposed to really understand yourself first. Love yourself, and then you can love others. You've all heard that. And so from a corporate point of view, that means that we need to understand who we are as a brand and business before we even have any customer. Who are we? Why? What's our why? What do we stand for? What's our mission? What's our vision? And not just a corporate social responsibility one, but a real one. I'm like, well, why do we exist? And if we know that, and if we're solid about that, then customers will be attracted by that. Just like people are attracted to healthy relationships by people who've done the work on themselves. And so I think knowing your why, look at Patagonia. Patagonia is why we're in business, to save our home planet. Yeah, that's a pretty big one, isn't it? I mean, they're an outwear, leisure wear brand, but they're in business to save our home planet. They know why they exist. So ask yourself the question, do you know why you exist? Are you good at communicating that to your customers? And then learn to give maybe more than you get in a relationship, and take personal responsibility for that. Second last attribute I want to talk about, number 9, is personal space. Now, a really unhealthy relationship would be one where, you know, someone is up in there, in your face all the time, checking your phone messages, always going out with you, not letting you go out with your friends. You know, that creepy invading of your personal space. Not a good healthy relationship from a personal point of view, obviously, but we do this every day in corporate. So when we reach in to social media and do sponsored ads, when we reach into someone's LinkedIn message box, I'm sure you've all had this experience of opening your LinkedIn messages and thinking they were personal, but seeing they're sponsored, it's not creepy. It's kind of like this, look, it's like, we are shouting at our customers, we're shouting at them, and no one wants to be shouted at, so you're invading my personal space. So think about your communication strategy, and think about, what are we saying and why are we saying it? You better be pretty certain, particularly as we lean into the conversation economy and start to use things like WhatsApp to actually communicate with our customers. It's a very personal space, a very personal platform. Make sure that your communication is contextual, is of value to me, not just trying to sell me stuff, but is genuinely personal, contextual, and of added value to me. That's the way that it's appropriate. Otherwise, you're just invading my personal space. And as I said, no one likes their personal space invaded in a relationship. And the last one I want to talk about is humor. Every single dating app in the world on their profiles will have, you know, good sense of humor, must have good sense of humor. It's because humor is a great way of kind of bypassing the emotional stuff, getting straight into the heart. If you make someone smile, if you make someone laugh, there's instantly emotional engagement. And emotional engagement is how we build customer lifetime value and brand loyalty. So we have to make people laugh and smile. One way is to delight and excite your shopper, your consumer, and go beyond their expectations. But another way is to just use humor. You know, make them laugh. And sometimes corporations get very serious and they think they can't do it. And social media is great. I mean, look at these two from Royal Mail and Tesco. Royal Mail, you know, taking the piss out of someone in terms of Valentine's Day, not getting cards. Here's Tesco Mobile burning a customer in terms of, you know, can you be fussy about getting a date? And so these are two examples of corporations on social media just having a bit of fun with their customers. And you can do this too. Doesn't matter whether it's B2B or B2C, you can have fun with your customers. Look at this one from a local funeral director recently on the vaccine. You know, you can, even if the product is serious, you can actually have some fun. So think about that. Think about using humor in the customer journey. Find the appropriate places, obviously, and this will differ by culture depending on where you are in the world. But make sure that you do embed humor, whether it's in the packaging, whether it's in the customer journey, whether it's in social media, whether it's in communications. You don't have to be serious all the time. Using humor is a great way into a customer's heart. So listen, they are the 5 attributes from today. If you add up all those from the last 5 from series 1, 2, you get 10 attributes of forming love as a verb, forming deep relationships with your customers. Am I suggesting you do all these all the time? No, of course not. What I'm saying is, look at your customer journey, look at how you interact with customers, and take one or two of these for each moment of the customer journey and try and bring them to life. Try and show your customer you care, show them that you love them, show them that you are serious about customer lifetime value and brand loyalty. If we do this, particularly on digital, we have to really look at our digital interactions and say, well, how can we get away from just the transactional one-click, one-swipe world of digital and actually start to embed some of these into our digital interactions? So that's the way we're going to form relationships as the world tips more in towards a digital existence. that we will have deep relationships with our customers. That was episode 2 of the Love is a Verb series. Tune in for episode 3, where we're going to talk about love languages and how we can really activate that love is a verb piece. Until then, I'm Ken Hughes. I'll see you then.